This video is sponsored by Skillshare, and if you haven't yet heard of them, Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of great inspiring classes. 3D modeling has become a bit of a thing in my life thanks to Skillshare. I've just started another course on there called Bring Your Illustrations to Life with Blender 3D by one of my favorite Skillshare teachers named Remington Markham. He's just so good at taking you through every single step from conception to finished work in such a succinct, considered manner. It's just paced so well that it doesn't leave you behind while being fast enough to remain engaging, and it makes me feel like I can make things that aren't hideous, which is an achievement in my books. There's plenty of great courses on there on a range of different topics covering all skill levels, and the first 1,000 people to use the link in my description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium Membership, and after that it's only around $10 a month, so you may as well click that link and check it out, and on to the video. Right out of the gate, Seven Samurai 20XX on the PlayStation 2 sets itself the near impossible task of respectfully remaking the Akira Kurosawa masterpiece that is Seven Samurai, a film that's influence can't be understated, and a film that's been prone to being remade and retold in several different ways since its release back in 1954. Fast forward to 2004 and two official Kurosawa estate authorized remakes release alongside the film's 50th anniversary. Samurai 7, a futuristic sci-fi anime TV series, and Seven Samurai 20XX, a futuristic sci-fi anime PS2 game. Surprisingly, these don't tie into one another, they're entirely separate retellings of the same thing that both happen to be really similar. 20XX is a funny game to exist. To adapt such a deliberately paced and artful film where every frame could be a painting into what's basically a spectacle fighter with PS2 animations and a Final Fantasy looking cast with corny dialogue is such a baffling idea that it can't help but draw your attention, especially with the back of the box boldly claiming that it's a digital remaster of the greatest samurai tale of all time. Further attracting attention is the proudly marketed involvement of two very renowned artists on this project. One being the late Jean Giraud, or Mobius, who was a massively influential French artist who did a lot of distinct sci-fi and fantasy comics, as well as helping visually conceptualize some high-profile movies like Alien and Tron and The Fifth Element. He was brought on to do the character designs here, as well as drum up press and in some ways help legitimize the project. And you could say the same thing about the Oscar-winning high-profile electronic musician Ryuichi Sakamoto, who was maybe more obviously a marketing ploy as he only came on to do the opening and ending themes, which are at least the standout tracks in the game. So you have the involvement of two massively influential names that a cynic might say were brought in more for publicity rather than to meaningfully improve the game, and you have an officially approved remake of an all-time classic movie, only it's a cheesy-looking PS2 game, and the expectation going into this isn't fueled by excitement as much as it is a sort of confused curiosity. It's just weird, and the great task of putting this all together fell to a developer named Dimps, who were only just founded 4 years earlier, and were at the time known for the Sonic Advance games and a handful of licensed fighting games. If this wasn't their most expensive project at the time, it was at least their most ambitious. There's two ways that you can remake media or retell a story, or rather, there's two ends of a spectrum. You can ride the line really close and try to moment to moment recapture the original as accurately as possible, or you can take plenty of creative liberties to the point where the source material is barely recognizable, and where most remakes sit somewhere between those two extremes, it's obvious which end 20XX leans towards. At its core, this is still a story about seven samurai defending a village, and many key scenes are recreated here in some way, but so much has been added and changed. It's certainly not just a retelling of the story in a sci-fi setting. Take the seven samurai themselves. All but one of them are different characters with different names, with the only one really mirroring the film being the older, wiser, mature head of the group, who's introduced with the scene where he saves the child, or baby in this case, from being abducted. It's funny seeing this scene executed in such a different way to the film, with this cheesy dialogue and these silly looking characters.
Mind if I step a little closer?
I said get back!
Okay, no problem.
Could you see the baby? Does he have it?
Yes.
What's he doing? When other different characters recreate scenes from the movie, it typically doesn't come off quite as well. Like, there's a scene in the film where one of the samurai, who's a very loose cannon, wild, unpredictable type, falsely rings the village alarm out of frustration to get the villagers to come out of their homes. In the game, when the alarm is rang by the cool dude prankster guy, it doesn't quite resonate in the same way. Also, we all remember the deleted scene from Seven Samurai where two roller skating brothers randomly appear and start dropping some sick bars before getting in a fight with one of the samurai.
Yo, Mew! What's up, Kai? Yeah, I'm glad we waited. Right, I think that these guys have finally made it. They requested that it's hoping to be. You're the one that Agent sent us to see.
Graves are being rolled in, and you'd think that context would help with this scene, but it just doesn't. Like, this just sort of happens halfway through the game, and it sticks out as one of its most bizarre moments. Notice there I said one of, because this game has plenty of weird moments. Like when you come across a funky guitar dude and fight him too for seemingly no reason at all, and when you kill him, there's even less closure because he just fades away like any other regular enemy would, and you go on your merry way. Alongside the leads, the villains here have also been changed from bandits into what the game calls humanoids, which seem to range from mutants to robots, and there's something of a war going on between humans and humanoids. It's an excuse to throw one-dimensional enemies at you between cutscenes in what is a fairly straightforward game structurally that swaps between combat and cutscene, with the occasional running around and talking to people section. And I hope you like mashing square, because that's all this combat really is. There's no jump button, there's no grabs, there's no throws, just mash the attack button. There is a dash and there is a block, and you can use the combos seen in the pause menu, but you'll be just fine mashing away. Press R1 and L1 at the same time, provided a meter is full, and you'll go into a dual blade mode where the combat is far more fluent and responsive, and if you time a dash or a block at just the right time, you'll refill that meter without having to wait for a cooldown. Blocking and dodging is sometimes pretty important when the game very occasionally gets tough, so that at least adds something to it, but then a poor frame rate and way too many enemies and effects on the screen at once and a terrible camera drag the whole thing down. At one point, I had the camera stuck during a boss battle and just fought the boss off in the distance. You can use a trigger to recenter the camera behind you, but it doesn't always work and it's pretty finicky when it does, and the right analog stick does absolutely nothing, which is criminal. So whether you're versing a boss or a minion, just mash square on them and block and dodge occasionally. It takes very little thought, but hey, at least it's flashy. It certainly looks a lot more complicated than it really is, and it does get pretty repetitive where enemies can just keep spawning for way too long, but at least landing hits is fairly punchy. It's also a shame that you only ever play as one of the seven samurai in this game, an always cocky young anime protagonist named Nato, who says that was easy after every single fight, no matter what. He says it so often that it genuinely lowers the stakes of what's going on, and he even says it after the final boss.
That was easy.
He also makes a lot of terrible quips, and I'm not sure if they're meant to be funny or not, but they are.
Dry has given me great powers.
More like greater ugliness.
Amazing. Not only do you not get to play as any of the other samurai, you never even get to fight alongside any of them or anyone else, because 20XX always does that classic video game thing of making any excuse it can for you to be alone. You go check out what's going on and we'll wait here. There's even a point where a gate conveniently drops right down between you and your companions, and It's a real shame that it keeps doing this, because the game struggles with properly building relationships and making you care about anyone, and part of the reason for that is because you're always alone outside of the cutscenes. That's not to say you don't spend a lot of time with them in the cutscenes, because there's a lot of cutscenes in this game with some of them running at over 10 minutes long, but there's simply way too many new subplots and characters that don't have enough room to breathe. A lot of new plot lines are set outside of the village and built around recruiting new samurai, and random characters like those rappers or that green guitar guy turn up as quickly as they disappear, so it can be hard to decipher which new characters or moments actually matter and which will vanish from the game for good. And where most of your time is spent solving problems to recruit samurai, little time is left for properly characterizing anyone or establishing the group dynamics. Like, These might look like generic Final Fantasy characters despite Mobius' involvement, but you only get glimpses of that fun, bantery Final Fantasy group adventure appeal. As far as what's actually here, there's this constant feeling that you've always missed a crucial bit of information to fully understand what's going on, and you're waiting for everything to come together and click, but chances are you haven't missed anything and it won't click, it's just all very rushed and confusing. A far cry from the original film's deliberate slow burn. You can beat the game in just 5 hours, but it feels like 20 hours of story has been cut down and crammed into that 5 hours. It's a shame too, because while a lot of the cutscenes can be enjoyable because you laugh at them rather than with them, or because they're just so goofy, like there's an entire out of nowhere sequence where you hunt down a humanoid disguised as a human adult worker, there's also a handful of well-directed, well-choreographed scenes that would be emotionally hard-hitting if I cared about anything that was going on. One of the major character deaths is particularly well done, where a guy breaks down in tears after seeing his wife trapped in this demonic sculpture while haunting music plays and the building collapses. It's a really well-executed scene, but not enough groundwork has been laid, so it almost works better in a vacuum. You barely know who this guy is, and you didn't know he had a wife, and you only know a few things about the samurai who sacrifices his life to save him, and you're not completely sure why any of this is happening. Like, obviously you wouldn't want it all to be spelled out, but I do want to at least care a bit about what's going on more than a superficial level. Again, the game spends way too much time with strange bosses that turn invisible, and with random off-to-the-side subplots about injections turning people into demonic dragons, when it should be developing the main cast's personalities and relationships to support those random subplots, because those bosses and subplots should be much more amusing than they are. Like, there's one villain who's always talking about wanting to make you her pet, and it has all the undertones that you'd expect.
Your eyes glint when you get angry. I like that. I think you'll love being my pet. You see, we humanoids are superior creatures.
Oh, how far we've strayed from Seven Samurai. One chapter in the game has you walking around an open city area. Like, usually obnoxious green arrows mindlessly lead you through incredibly linear levels, but just this once it opens up to let you wander around, and this is where you get the sense that this was meant to be a bigger game. It's a surprisingly large area, the otherwise useless minimap finally serves a purpose here, and parts of it are well detailed and atmospheric, like the bar or the casino. It's also where you bump into a lot of what I later found out online are bonus bosses like the guitar guy, which to me feel like Mobius character designs that the developers couldn't find a better use for. The pause menu details little backstories for each boss and for each of their weapons. I have a theory that there may have been one point in development where you were meant to pick up these weapons and use them for yourself, because it seems strange that there's an entire weapons menu here that serves no practical purpose. I think it's fairly obvious that this game was meant to be much broader in scope than it is, and you can definitely feel a love and care radiating from at least some of it. There's certainly a level of creativity and a lot of fun ideas through and throughout too, but it's just too hard to clearly decipher what the game has to say, and it's too hard to enjoy it all for what it is, between not knowing or caring enough about what's going on, and being drowned in repetitive combat that could be removed from the game entirely without much consequence. It really isn't far off just mashing square to unlock the next cutscene, and to top it all off, there's long loading screens around every corner. Towards the end, you'd think it'd all start to get more cohesive as the story would narrow towards simply defending the village, but it doesn't. Instead, the entire plot shifts in focus towards protecting this mute pink-haired girl who the humanoids are hunting because she has a sacred jewel, but she gave that jewel to someone else, and a dude in a white suit gets involved, and you have to go to some crazy magic library to take out these things called guardians, and it's just so exhaustingly convoluted. Unlike the film, the town and its villages get very, very little screen time, and by this point, the game feels like it's doing everything it can to avoid actually being an adaptation of Seven Samurai, but we do at least get another genuinely well put together final cutscene that I simply wish I could enjoy more. Really, I wish I could enjoy Seven Samurai 20XX more because it's emblematic of why the PlayStation 2 has such a great library. This wacky, questionable taste remake of a respected classic film with high profile collaborators and a reasonably high budget for the time managed to get greenlit, and the fact that it's on the PS2 just makes it make some indescribable amount of sense. Like, of course this exists on the PS2, and while it has its moments and it is a spectacle seeing so many weird choices and tonal shifts, Seven Samurai 20XX is just not put together smoothly enough to let you really revel in them.